People of America, people of the world, you are listening to Beyond the Plate with Capi. Who else? I don't do it sometimes to fulfill other people's dreams, but to fulfill my own dreams. And if you do things to fulfill your dreams and you do it with heart and love, eventually happens that you also fulfill other people's dreams.
Hey everyone, this is Cappy and you're listening to Beyond the Plate, a podcast where I sit down in person with the world's culinary elite to explore their journey into the industry and the social impact they have made in their community. Every episode, we share inspiring stories of what it means to be in today's hospitality industry. For this episode, we sat with the incomparable chef Jose Andres. I do want to give you a heads up. This is our last Beyond the Plate episode for season one. Big season one finale, but we do have next week's episode of Just the Plate with Jose. He's going to do a recipe for us. It sounds quite delicious. But for season two updates, we do have some really awesome plans for that, to be very honest. We will tease them out shortly. But follow us on social media for all of our season two updates. You can find me at On Cappy's Plate across Instagram, Twitter, and whatnot. And then for the pod, we're at BT Plate Podcast on Twitter. And we also have a Facebook page, so we'll keep updates on there too. Also, a heads up. You can find us on Spotify now, which is super exciting. We are on iTunes and Google Play and Stitcher and Libsyn, and we have added Spotify. So you can find us on your Spotify app on your phones or computers or tablets. Back to the task at hand. Chef Jose Andres is an incredible human being. And my producers get mad at me when I say that every guest is incredible. But they are incredible. I truly believe that. Jose Andres is no stranger to the media these days. You've probably seen him feeding people in Puerto Rico after the devastating hurricanes, but that wasn't his first foray into this. Jose was quick to go to Haiti after the earthquakes in 2010. He was in Puerto Rico where they've served north of 3 million meals to those in need. He was in California during the wildfires feeding people. There's a beautiful piece on 60 Minutes just a month or two ago, which you may want to check out to get a little more in-depth perspective on what he's been up to. This is a chef, a man who's been named one of Time Magazine's 100 most influential people. He was awarded Outstanding Chef by the James Beard Foundation. He's internationally recognized. He's a culinary innovator. He's an author, an educator, which we talk about, a television personality, a humanitarian. And he's the chef owner of Think Food Group. Think Food Group is his restaurant group based in Washington, D.C. They have nearly 30 restaurants plus a food truck. These are located throughout the country, Mexico City. He has a fast casual concept called Beefsteak, which is a vegetable-driven fast casual concept, which we talk about. This man is also the pioneer of Spanish tapas in the United States. And he won't fully take credit for it, but you'll hear some more conversation about that later on in the episode. He's the only chef globally that has both a 2-star Michelin restaurant and 4 Bib Gourmands. He's an advocate of food and hunger issues. He champions the role of chefs in the national debate on food policy. He started a foundation in 2012 called World Central Kitchen. We talk about how and why and when. This is a nonprofit that provides smart solutions to hunger and poverty by using the power of food to empower communities and strengthen economies. I honestly could go on and on and on, and I'm going to stop right there because you're going to get a great sense. If you don't know Chef Jose Andres, you're going to get a great sense of him throughout this episode. So please enjoy this conversation as we go beyond the plate for the season one finale with Chef Jose Andres.
So we are here on the very much where I be close to where I began in Washington, D.C. We are in my office, even. I don't think this is the office. This is kind of, you can see, has sofas, and it's just a place to hang up and rest and meet and talk and dream. And I can see the National Archives from here, and I can see the Navy Memorial, which I love because I was a Navy boy in Spain. So, and Jaleo and my restaurants are very much walking distance, less than a minute.
Just on a personal front, I wanted to let you know I ran into Rich Melman last week in Chicago.
Wow.
He's a big fan of yours.
Well, to walk in the streets of Chicago and I'm finding Richard Melman. You guys, you need to understand, it's like if you are in Rome and you're walking, looking for a restaurant, and all of a sudden you find the Pope. Imagine you are a Catholic Christian, even if you're not. It's like a very big deal. So Richard Melman, he's given me great counseling over the years. He's been in the distance, always a very big force of good influence. He showed that you can have multiple restaurants, company, and do everything at a fairly high level. And it's great to see that now his children are following his path. But Richard Melman very much has been one of the, I will say, one of the top guys in the industry for so many years now. We're talking 20, 30 plus years.
Yeah, he's amazing.
40 years.
Yeah, and I know you and your business partner won or received the Rich Melman Award from Restaurant Hospitality Magazine a little while back. The second connection is we met because I was in Las Vegas for New Year's of 2010 at the Cosmopolitan opening, and I came up to you to reintroduce myself to let you know I work with Rachel Ray and I work on her charity, and you were tending the wood burning paella pit, and it looked like that was like your candy store, like as a kid, like you didn't want to leave that paella pit, but you were so kind to me, and I believe you had gotten back from Haiti recently in 2010. You were telling me about some work there. So I know you've been up to good things over the years. I know you've been spending a heck of a lot of time in Puerto Rico and California, which we'll get into. But, you know, in reading around, I see people have been calling you the face of American disaster relief. Mm. And I know you've been a huge supporter with DC Central Kitchen in Haiti from the 2010 earthquakes and Puerto Rico and California and more and more. My question is, when did you have this sense of urgency that you need to help?
Well, we are in a business that nobody will doubt. We feed the few. Even in our more modest price restaurants, we feed the few. It's a whole bunch of people in America or around the world that they don't have the opportunity, probably the willing, but not the money to come to restaurants like mine. And this is one part. But another part is deeper than that. The part is that we all seem, especially in cities, that we live together in this kind of open cities that seems everybody is welcome everywhere. But the reality is that it's not the case. We are all broken apart in different neighborhoods. And you know who lives in each one. And they tell you that you cannot go to this one, or they tell you that you cannot go to that one because you are not welcome in very strange ways. Yeah. It's kind of the body language. And I do believe that if I really want to be giving to my daughters a better city, in this case Washington, a better world, I'm not going to do it by protecting them or building walls around them. It's what fathers and mothers we want to do, especially my daughters. You want to protect them to the end. But I learned that the best protection is breaking down the walls and show them the real world. And in my case, trying to improve a little bit the world they live in. And so if every father and mother do that, probably our children will find a better world tomorrow. So this is more about not thinking about building walls to protection. But this is about using those same walls to give people hope with better schools or facilities where they can spend the night if they're homeless, or facilities where they can have a plate of food if they are hungry. This is how we can be really giving our children a better tomorrow. So that's, I guess, what I do it.
Yeah. So you founded World Central Kitchen in 2012. Was there a moment that made you start World Central Kitchen?
Very much the first minute I arrived to Haiti in 2010.
Yeah.
I don't know, it was a few weeks after the earthquake. In the moment, we sensed that there was not going to be a problem. But when I arrived, I realized that after my experiences on DC Central Kitchen and then helping as a chairman found LA Kitchen, following my hero, Robert Egger. I mean, we mentioned Richard Melman, an amazing person, a person that always gives. Now we're talking about Robert Egger, another person that always thinks about others more than he thinks about himself. After we opened LA and he successfully done one of, again, the best food fighting organizations, hunger fighting organizations in America. I knew I wanted to do the same, but in this case, not in a city in the States, but then in a country that was in need. And we got money from a foundation that they gave me an award that was supposed to be personal money. I think it was $50,000 from the Bilsek Foundation that they were giving them every year to immigrants that had some impact in America. And my wife and I, we were like, what do we do with the money? We buy a car? Do we pay down the loan of the house? we said, let's put the money into creating World Central Kitchen. That will be a good use of the money. My partner, Robert, Rob Wilder, who was the one very much who brought me into Washington, D.C. with my other friend and partner, Robert Alvarez. Anyway, we put 50 grand each. We had 100,000 in the bank, and we said, let's dream what we can do with a foundation that is going to put food at the forefront, where we want to change the world through the power of food.
I've read how you use the line, the power of food, and the funny thing is, this is making me flashback, because this podcast called Beyond the Plate, I originally was going to call it The Power of Food, because I focus on, you know, what you do to give
back. So Think Food Group, where you are, this is the office where we are, our motto is really to change the world through the power of food.
Yeah.
So this is our company, pro-business company, but very much while the Think Food Group and World Central Kitchen, they are two different organizations. World Central Kitchen is a 501c3 and has nothing to do with Think Food Group. At the end, obviously, I am the founder of both, and one has nothing to do with the other, but then the values of one go with the other.
So you have nearly 30 restaurants around the world, quite frankly, now. And you could be in any of your restaurant kitchens right now or these days, but you're out cooking and arranging for those in need. And you've served, I think the number I heard is over 3 million meals now in Puerto Rico. How do you set a menu for something like that out in the field? Or are there any like commonalities you find that people take to, or is it they just need food?
Well, I think as today we are in the north of 3.3.
That's incredible.
We still have a kitchen that is, we have technically three kitchens that they're putting close between 6,000, 7,000, and 10,000 meals a day. We're probably going to have to increase a little bit more. Probably going to have to make it to 20 at least, because it's still a lot of pockets that we are identifying that they are not receiving the help they should. But I don't know. Listen, in the top of the crisis, we had 18 kitchens operating at the same time. And we opened 21. With the new one we opened in Dorado, is 22 total kitchens we opened. More on the north of 16,000 volunteers that they've been part of this. But the menu, you know, I at times I had to raise my voice, probably more I wanted to be heard. Even everybody was there with the willingness to help, so it was not difficult to lead. But I used the resources of the local community. I didn't go there trying to impose. I went there, number one, I went there only trying to help. But when I saw that we needed to do more than just trying to help, and that we had to take the lead on feeding many, I used the foods that were available and the talents of the local chef community, which, by the way, they are amazing. From So many, Santa Ella and Willow, Jose Enrique, Chef Piñero. I mean, it's so many, Manolo, it's so many that I don't want to keep mentioning.
Yeah.
Because it will not be fair to the ones I forgive. But the chefs of Puerto Rico, the best chefs of Puerto Rico, the best chefs of San Juan, when they lost, many of them lost their restaurants and their homes were underwater, or their family members, they didn't know where they were. But they didn't even could go to look for them because they didn't have gas and they were far away somewhere in the island. Those chefs came together and began use feeding people. And I was very, very, very lucky that there was kind of the wind behind the sails. And everybody began cooking, and what became 2,000 meals the Monday after the earthquake at Jose Enrique in Santurce, sorry, after the hurricane, it became more than, I think, one moment. One day we reached close to 170,000 meals in one day. So that was a dream that happened. Nothing else, nothing more. Only the chefs and the people of Puerto Rico, food trucks, many of them heroes, that they left everything behind and they didn't thought about themselves and their hardships, but they only thought about feeding others. That's what it took. Nothing else, nothing more.
So in 2013, you became an American citizen.
Big day.
Big day. What does it mean to you to be a U.S. citizen?
Well, I think today means even more than ever. Obviously, you know, I cover up my lack of English by passion, probably, and by stories. And obviously, coming to the States as a Navy boy in the Spanish Navy in a four-mast tall ship, white, beautiful, 300 crew, coming into Pensacola, a town that celebrated the festivities of the five flags, which one of them was the Castilian Spanish flag, that left a big mark on me. And obviously knowing about the initial, with all due respect to the Indians were already here, or the Vikings that came first, but knowing the Spanish influence in the initial discovery of America, and especially the U.S., that a lot of people are not aware. And then arriving in New York, on top of the mast, probably 20-something meter up in the air, and going under the Verrazano Bridge and seeing Manhattan in the distance and the Statue of Liberty and Ellis Island on my left, that leaves you a big mark. So when I finished my military service and I came back to the States, I knew that I wanted to be... I was young, I was close to 21, going to 22. I knew I wanted to be part of this dream. And I learned that you don't have to have a passport or born in a place, that you belong by working. You belong by working for your own, for your loved ones, but you were working to the betterment of the place you live. And that's a big message. I've been here, you know, the biggest part of my adult life. So yes, I became American in 2013, but I can tell you, I think I became American many, many years before. I didn't need a passport to feel I belong here. I know where I come from and I love Spain, but I know where I belong. And I have three American-born daughters, but you don't need to give somebody a passport to make them feel. We have 11 million undocumented that I cannot speak on behalf of every one of them, but I can tell you that the vast majority of them, they may come from other countries, but they are every day waking up, working 12, 14 hours a day, and loving this country as much as anybody. You are American because you love, you belong, because you work hard, and because you love what America stands for.
Yeah,
and that's what makes you an American.
You're from Asturias. Am I pronouncing it right?
Yeah, Asturias. I was born
Asturias, Spain. How did that town, city, village? How did that influence your life?
Well, I was very young. I have flashbacks of growing up there, and my mother, who already passed away last year, she was always amazed that I could remember certain things, like the hunting dogs of my grandfather, which, again, I was five. And she will be amazed that I will even remember, because she was like, well, they die right after. I mean, after we left Asturias and we moved to Barcelona. So I guess they influenced me in ways that I moved to Barcelona when I was five. So again, I was very young. But I've been always very attached to Asturias, as I am very attached to Barcelona and Catalonia. And I think it was like I came back to Asturias probably 10, 11 years later. So imagine 11 years passed. But it's something very funny. It has to be in the DNA. In the moment I arrived, my family was waiting there in this old, small, little town train station in a December 21st, three days before Christmas. And the family was there waiting in the station. Almost looked like a commercial. And those things, you smart, you, it's almost like you say, okay, I also belong here. In my case, I feel so comfortable in so many places that my biggest regret is obviously the place I am is where I belong in that moment, and I try to give my best. But I always have that sense that I want to belong to so many more places.
I feel that. Do you remember what your kitchen table was like growing up, whether it was Asturias or Barcelona?
Totally. I mean, we moved to three homes right after we came to Barcelona. We were renting here, renting there. And finally, my mother and father, middle class nurses, working in a nearby restaurant. they had a restaurant for a little bit, but working in a hospital.
Got it.
There were nurses working in a hospital. Well, even I have a feeling like some restaurants should have nurses to take care of the food coma that some of us we go through. I think that should be the trend of 2018. But my table, the kitchen was small. It's when the refrigerators began being slightly bigger. Before they were super small, I remember. And in the kitchen, you know, if you were three people, you know, you had to be very careful with your moves because it was no bigger than that. But all you needed. And I remember the beginning of the month when my father got the paycheck. That is when the big supermarkets, the big markets began opening. The Carrefours of the world and the Costcos of the world. And we will go. But this didn't happen at the beginning. I saw that this happened over the years and years. And my father will fill up. And my mother, the refrigerator and the dry goods. And towards the end of the month, the refrigerator that once was super busy and super full, it became super empty. And I almost was like a sad thing to open the refrigerator. You know, everything was semi-gone, the butter. Was gone. Everything was gone. But I don't remember any of the cooking of the beginning of the month. Much of the cooking I remember is always the last week, where my mom will make this bechamel with the leftover chicken, and she will chop it up, and maybe one egg that was left, and she'll put it up in the bechamel, and then she'll make croquetas. And all bread, my father will make garlic soup with water. And some cloves of garlic and a little bit of olive oil and some Spanish pimenton, the paprika. And those are the dishes I really remember. The end of the month dishes more than the beginning. But in the little town we moved after my father and mother bought this house, Santa Coloma de Cervelló, 1 hour away from Barcelona. You know, I remember having the little fish place, the little bakery, the little fruit place. And will be a ritual almost every day, going to the bread, going to the chicken place if you were eating chicken or beef that day, going for the vegetables maybe for 2-3 days. But almost the ritual of shopping was almost a daily ritual. And this is probably something I miss enormously when you live in the suburbs here, for example, in DC, that it's hard to do that in a neighborhood with all the homes scattered. You have always to grab the car. And to me, I miss that ritual of just leaving home and walking and buying and saying hi and the mailman and buying the milk. We'll buy the milk almost daily. And I miss that. I guess we don't have so much time anymore, but I miss that. I want to dream that one day I'm going to be living in a neighborhood that everything will be walking distance, yeah. And you will go one place at a time and where everybody is the expert.
It's my favorite part about going to Europe, parts of Spain or Paris. I always tell anyone traveling there, go buy a loaf of bread, go buy then some cheeses, then some meats, then some, and it's so nice. What was your first restaurant job? Was it in Spain?
I mean, my first restaurant job really was that's a great question. But my first, and by that mean that I got paid. So I had to be 15th going to 16th and was in the convention center of Barcelona near the Plaza de España, a big square that from there some of the bigger avenues use very much break Barcelona in 3-4 big areas. And there the convention center, which by the way is beautiful, was a little restaurant inside to cater to the convention goers, was called L'Univers. In Catalan means the universe. And it was a typical restaurant that will be, you know, depends the convention with people with more or less money. It will have, you know, 3-4 first courses, 3-4 main courses, and 3 or 4 desserts. You'll pay a price and you choose. And so we'll have to be doing, you know, hundreds, if not thousands, of meals in very short time. And they hired me, and I remember they used to pay me 5,000 pesetas for a day's of work that roughly will be around 8-9 hours. We'll be, began the day very early, and 5,000 pesetas will be like what? What is 5,000 pesetas now? Like $20-$30 maybe. But we're talking, you know, 30-something years ago. Not bad for a 15-year-old kid.
Were you cooking?
Oh, yeah. We will make...
Did you love it? Did you know
salmon
you
love it? Small. We will cure salmon with sugar and juniper berries and salt. But we'll do like, you know, 100 halves of salmon, yeah, which I never understood why they didn't bought the smoked salmon already, but this one was cured. But I guess I understand now. It was cheaper to make it and to buy it. And
did you know you loved cooking then?
Oh, yeah. Big way. Big
Were you
way.
Cooking at home?
I cook at home since I was young. I still remember when, before we moved outside Barcelona, we used to live near a beautiful hospital called the Hospital of Sant Pau, which is a hospital anybody going to Barcelona should go because the architecture is unbelievable. And we live there in a street called Padre María Claret and was, you know, an apartment building. I remember that the first thing I made was one of those cakes that you buy the box and everything is there, which, by the way, they are not the same anymore. In the old days, it's true that in the old days, some of those things were better. And these, I'm sorry, but this is a message to the food industry. Those things in the old days, they used to be better. So technology has helped make more money and sell it cheaper, which is amazing, that they can make more money and sell it cheaper, which is always good to sell cheaper, but it's not better. And it's not so cheap anymore anyway. And I made one of those cakes. I think that one was the like a lemon sponge cake that had the powders to make the cream and bake the genoise and what they call the bizcocho. And I used to make that one, I remember, because it was easy, you read the ingredients. And it was this is a great way for making anybody to start cooking because it makes you very successful very quickly. But anyway, I always cook, my father always cook, my mother always cook. Remember that cooking back then in Spain and many other countries around the world is a pleasure, but it's really a necessity. You don't have the money to go out, or you don't have enough money to go out every day, and more if you are a family of five. The salary doesn't give for more, and it's fine. But, you know, this is the moment that you see that a pound of chickpeas and ham hock, a little piece of bone, or half a chicken, or quarter chicken, and some lentils, they go a long way.
Yeah. So then you're 18, 19, you apprentice under Ferran Adrià at El Bulli, one of the best chefs in the world and one of the best restaurants of our time. Could you give me 3 words to describe Ferran?
3 words? No. Well, one would be a genius, because he's a genius. The other one will be unselfish. He shared everything he knew. The world today, the culinary world today, every single chef in the world, even the ones don't recognize it, they wouldn't be cooking today if Ferran was not there. Even the ones that say they've never been influenced by him, they've been influenced by him. It's unbelievable. The techniques he opened and the thinking about creativity beyond cooking. Genius is one and selfish is the other, and persistent. He never stops. He goes and goes and goes. He's one of the big thinkers of our time. He probably, Ferran was a biology, a medical researcher, probably cancer will be wiped out. Or if he was the owner of a big pharmaceutical industry, every single person in poor countries will have access to medicines. at an affordable price. That's who Varane is very much.
Yeah. Did you ever think you'd be teaching a class with him at Harvard?
Well, he's even smart for that. When we came first to Harvard on the first visit, and the seed kind of was planted to create the classes, you know, very much he's like, well, you're going to have to, you know, you're closer than me to Harvard. So at the beginning, you know, we spent a lot of time making them successful, and then in a very Ferran way, you know, we made it very inclusive to bring every single chef that was out of our movement involved, many at the beginning from Spain, because it's where all this way of thinking came from, really. But then some of the great American chefs, you know, like, so very amazing. I just came back a few weeks ago from giving the last lecture in the last class. I usually give the first and the last I try, one or the other or both, to make sure we start well or we end well. And it's always good to see the professors there and the students especially. And just to see that food is a mechanism and a way to teach physics. It's very interesting. It's very fun.
Yeah. And so then you wind up being also affiliated teaching with the George Washington University here in DC. So my question for you, Professor Andres, you're a father of three girls. What lessons are you teaching them? You touched on them earlier a little
bit. Well, you know, we are living interesting times. Having three daughters in today's DNA, it's very interesting because we are seeing what has happened in 2017, that all of the sudden has been all this talk about how we are treating women in the workplace, and from Hollywood, even these other industries, it seems nothing is happening. But probably there's a lot of issues there. But the restaurant industry has been obviously at the heart of the issue. Obviously, it's one of the bigger industries in America. Over 10% of Americans work in restaurants. So it's big on the economy. It's big on the employment. So we are one of the big industries. And only thinking that I have three daughters, the same way I always said that I want to leave a better wall for them, and not building walls and making sure the wall is good enough that they can be safe and happy anywhere. It's the same, obviously, with the work environment. At the end, especially because my work in Haiti, I've seen that women are slaves of the system. We have the people that feed humanity are not men. Even professional kitchens seems they are run by men. The women that really feed the world are the people that feed the world are women. And I say that because I've been doing a lot of work on clean cook stoves and trying to bring clean cooking so we can liberate those women from health issues because of smoke and time, because they spend enormous quantities of time because charcoal cooking is slower, or putting them in harm's way because they send young girls to the forest and things happen to them. Or they don't go to school because they have to be in the forest looking for wood. And all the bad things that go around cooking with charcoal, that women are, or we see that women are sex slaves all over the world. And many of them start very young. So women are, we always say that women are the future. But I think we should stop saying that women are the future and begin saying that women are the present. We always talk about the weak sex. Oh, well, it's not like women are any weaker than men because the DNA of men makes us taller and maybe stronger because of our muscles. But we should start having that thought that yes, we men are stronger, but precisely because physically maybe we're stronger, we need to be using that precisely for protection, not for taking advantage of. And I think it's going to be the big one in 2018, obviously. Everything came quick, but this has been going on not only for the last 10 or 20 years. This has been humanity for the last 3,000-4,000 since humanity. That women somehow they've been taken advantage of, when at the same time they are the backbone of our society. Women are the backbone of our society, but we cannot be just taking advantage of them in any way or form. And so it's gonna, as a father of three, I'm very happy all of this is finally coming to light, because I hope we are all together gonna make a better world for every single woman in America and overseas, especially in the restaurant industry. But I think we're gonna have to have more women leading. My CEO in my company, Kimberly Grant, she's the best CEO I imagine. Happens, she's a woman. But I'm very proud she is, and that we are led by. But again, what I'm trying to teach my three daughters is precisely that they need to speak up, that they need to be strong, that they need to be taking the lead when they think they should be taking the lead, and to speak up about anything that they feel is wrong. And men, we're going to have to be right there, supporting and also speaking up. Me, I've been going through a lot of thinking. I have obviously a very big company, and we've been always very serious about making sure that the workplace is a safe, good, happy environment, but people can fulfill their dreams and become anything they want. And if anything, we've been going through even more questions about what else we should be doing. Not only to make sure that nothing happens, but to make sure that we also can become a voice that everybody works with us when they go and they start working somewhere else, or they began their own companies, that they can bring with them a good work ethic, where everybody, but especially women, are treated with the respect they deserve.
You know, chefs have made headlines recently, as you alluded to, because I sat and chatted with Tom Colicchio. I think that the morning I chatted with him, you had put out a tweet saying something along, don't quote me on this, but something along the lines of, the answer is not staying away from these restaurants. Yes, these chefs may have done some things, but there's a staff of people that are trying to earn a living for their family and pay rent and pay bills. And I asked Tom, and you know, he said it's personal, you know, whether what you decide to do or not. But what needs to, and I just actually came from a meeting at the National Restaurant Association before here, and they love you. They were talking about the Capital Food Fight event with DC Central Kitchen. But what needs to be done?
Well, I mean, listen, myself as a father of three girls, as a husband of one beautiful wife, as the leader of my organization, Think Food Group, with hundreds, if not thousands, of people in many cities. All of these very much began in my time when I was in Puerto Rico, and I've been trying to put a lot of thinking and trying to be a voice, because I've been having these conversations first with my daughters, because you know, some of the chefs that they've been finger point as doing something that we can say as wrong, is people they know. Because different festivals, because there are people, some of them they've been friends, and I began seeing myself explaining what happened to my daughters, and the conversation is not long. Right? Is that what happens at the end in every one's of our lives matters. We are surrounded by people. I always say that we are as good as the people we have around us, and I do believe that's true. And that means to speak up. And obviously, I've been working in my same company 25 years, and I can tell you that in my company we believe we've done things well. We've been done things. Making sure that the integrity of every person, and especially woman, is non-negotiable. we have human resources, we have, but this shouldn't be beyond human resources. It should be a certain human decency that we know what's right and what's wrong. And you can always maybe do something like somebody takes it in the wrong way, and it's very simple. No is no, and an apology should be done right there, that minute. When we see something wrong, needs to be a red flag should be raised, and people should know where they should be going to ask for help if they feel powerless. That's a very obvious one, and again, should not be allowed, should be non-negotiable. I don't have the answer for you, but I've been putting a lot of thinking on I know my company. I want to believe that we are a great company in that sense, and that things like these, they are non-negotiable and they are not allowed. But this goes beyond that. What are we doing as humans, and especially as men? What are we doing that we are putting so many women in uncomfortable situations? What are we doing as a society? What are we doing when we talk about women in such a disrespectful way? I do believe women are the most important part of our society. They don't only keep moving humanity forward, and they don't carry life for 9 months at a time with the sacrifice that takes, and that men, we take it for granted, I guess. Even I've been a father of three, I can never understand and feel what it means to carry a life in your belly for 9 months. But that's precisely what we need to be, a star, seeing women of what they are. And especially when you go to poor countries and poor communities, I see that women, they take all the burden of the families, and they don't get sometimes the respect they deserve. And we need to start everywhere to make sure that we give women the dignity that they deserve, and that we protect them against all attacks from people, men, that don't see them as what they are. Probably the most important part in our society.
Yeah, thank you. Switching gears here, you're credited for bringing small plates dining concepts to America. You kind of changed the vernacular on things. So do I have you to thank for every server in America saying they suggest I order 2 to 3 plates?
Well, I'm not going to lie to you. If Haleo, when we opened in 93, was in New York or in LA, San Francisco, probably even the whole thing will happen much quicker. I was not the one that brought tapas to America. It's been a Spanish restaurants for many, many years. It's been a Spanish cooking for long time, since the first Spanish conquistador set foot in what is now the United States. But maybe what Haleo was in 1993 even was others, like Richard Mellman with Camino Sotelino, had Baba Riva in Chicago. But what Haleo really did was believing that you could have a big menu, that the dishes were going to be small, and that you emphasize that sharing is what we wanted you to do. And that probably nowhere else in America this was happening. You know, even in Spain, you will go and hear the waiter telling you how you eat tapas.
Right.
And they will laugh at you in the face.
Right.
Even if you're a tourist, they will not explain to you. Because tapas, even in Spain, are enjoyed in a different way than they are enjoyed here, even has changed. Tapas was used bar and was bar food, standing up and barely sitting down. But tapas, a place like Haleo, was very unique. 1993 was not a place like Haleo. Was not a place that, again, emphasized tapas, small dishes, and sharing, and where a table of four could have 12, 15 dishes at a fairly well price. So that's what Haleo did, probably. And without realizing, use the tapas craze. I remember, like 10 years after Haleo in D.C., something very amazing began happening. Japanese restaurants began having tapas, some of them Japanese tapas. American restaurants began using American tapas. And I could tell you that happened in Washington, D.C. for a reason. So on that end, I know it happened. I saw it happening in my backyard. But then, you know, Washington is a place that many people visit. And I saw many other restaurants popping, and now it's crazy. The craziness of Spanish food using Washington is just out of the roof. I never imagined it was going to be so many Spanish restaurants opening. But all across America, obviously, over the last 25 years has exploded. But this more is needed, and more ingredients and better quality Spanish food. But I'm very amazed and very happy of what has happened the last 25 years.
One of Time Magazine's 100 Most Influential People, Outstanding Chef by James Beard Foundation, President Barack Obama honors you with National Humanities Medal. So here's a story. I was reading through your bio, and I saw there was something that said, Andres's work has earned awards and distinctions, but I read it so quick that I read it as, Andres's work has earned awards and distractions. So my question for you is, are these sometimes distractions for you? Like, or do they bring any sort of pressure?
Yeah, they do. I'm 48 now. July 13th, I will be 49. So I'm about a year and a half from reaching 50. And I don't know how much more life I have after that, but you need to start thinking about that, no? It's 20, 30, 40 years. Well, if I change my eating habits, which they are all great, but maybe too much, and drinking habits, which maybe is a little bit more than I should, I hope I'll make it to 90. But one thing, I'm not going to lie to you. What I'm realizing is that time is my biggest asset. And time and the people you want to spend that time with around you. Or you around them if they allow you. Time for me is my biggest ingredient right now. And I got caught into this amazing opportunity to win a lot of different things. And the advice sometimes is just concentrate in one and do one very, very well. I never did anything very, very well. I'm more an instigator of beginnings, and I do it in part because I have a hard time concentrating for longer than an hour on anything, probably half an hour by now. I cannot believe that I say no to interviews, and I say no to TV, and I say no to TV shows. That maybe I had the option, even with my heavy accent, of being the host, of being. But you know, every time I say no, it's time again. And I barely have enough time anymore to win every one of my restaurants at the level I wanted. But again, when I say that I'm only as good as the team I have around me, this is no way I used to cover myself up, but that's true. Really, if I keep doing those restaurants, because always you have people that can take over them and younger people than you and do as good or better job that you did when you were running them on your own. And that's the reality.
Is there a moment you realized when you made it as a chef? I mean, you started with Haleo, you were 23. Is there a moment you realized this?
No, not really. I think probably all my life I was dreaming of Michelin stars, and then I got two with my team 2 years ago with a Michelin Game Gear RDC. But by then, even if I didn't got them, it's like, do we deserve them? And we answered to ourselves that maybe we do, because we've done a very good job for 15, 16 years without any guy telling us, just by our own belief that we are pushing ourselves to give a great experience. And so it's one moment that sometimes, quite frankly, not to sound in any way hopefully pretentious, but I don't do it sometimes to fulfill other people's dreams, but to fulfill my own dreams. And if you do things to fulfill your dreams and you do it with heart and love, eventually happens that you also fulfill other people's dreams. And they become part of you, well, the people working with you, or well, the people dining with you. And at the end, it's okay to open restaurants because that's your dream. I mean, I always said that it will be easier to be a writer because you write the book, you fix the book, and at the end, the words that you put on the book is the words that you think they're very good and are going to be always the same words. Unfortunately, with cooking, it's not the case. You come up with dishes and you cook the dishes next to your people, but then one day somebody else is cooking it for you. But it's more difficult that maybe it's always the same. But then it's different. And different doesn't mean worse. Different means different. And what I'm very happy is that we are able to manage so many, many restaurants, and I'm part of so many stories. I always say that my restaurants are really books, and the dishes are the way for me to be telling the story. And I'm very happy we have so many stories, and I'm very happy that the stories can be read in different ways with different people.
So you received 2 Michelin stars with Mini Bar here in D.C., and then you go and open, or you've opened multiple fast casual restaurants. And I know fast casual restaurants are kind of like a thing these days, but I feel like you didn't just jump on this train just to jump on it. I feel like this has more meaning to you. Can you tell us about Beefsteak?
Well, we spoke at the beginning that Thin Food Group stands for to change the world through the power of food. And I had already a food truck that was Pepe. That was our way to say, can we make a great sandwich concept and make it happen? But then we were thinking about opening more Pepes. And before we did that, I was like, you know, if we want really to try to help change the world through the power of food, there's plenty of sandwich restaurants, plenty of pizza places, plenty of burger places. Even there's always going to be room for one more if it's good and the business makes sense. But I thought what America wants and America needs, and nobody seems is giving it to them, is use more vegetables and fruits. And so the challenge was, can we do one restaurant that can have, A, the hope of becoming a restaurant, fast food concept that we can have many around the States. And that was the challenge. And can we make it successful and profitable? And then if it's not, can we ignite the passion and the interest of other chefs like me to try to do the same until one of the concepts sticks? And we have, will be great news that the next McDonald's is a restaurant that 99% of the menu is based on vegetables. That will be the best news of this century. And I think it's going to happen. It'll be me. And, well, I hope so. But if it's not me, you know, I'm not greedy. I hope it'll be other. And I'll say, man, I miss that point. I miss that opportunity. But it's okay to try to do it yourself, but then be happy when somebody else do it. It's always somebody better or smarter out there. And the next Burger King or McDonald's is around the corner. Let's hope is one that can feed one day the masses, taking care of everybody, taking care of the employees the best they can, taking care of the environment the best they can, making sure it's more vegetables and vegetable protein. And let's hope we will see it in the next 5 or 10 years.
Yeah, I hope. Let's fly through a quick speed round here. About 8 questions, 7 and a bonus question. What'd you have for dinner last night?
Well, last night is unfair because I was cleaning the refrigerator from Christmas, New Year's, which this year we stay in D.C. because after so much traveling around California for the fires and Puerto Rico after the hurricane, I spent, you know, over 100-something days away from home. So we didn't want to go back to Spain like we go every year, or anywhere around the States like we do every year. We stay in Washington, in Bethesda. So I invited my good friend Seth Hurwitz, who is the founder and owner of 930 Club, who he now has the Anthem that probably is, without a doubt, the best music venue anywhere in the world, period. And his wife Caroline, and he loves to eat. He's a guy that, besides owning the Anthem, the best music venue in the world, is a guy that plays with the Foo Fighters drums and plays with Thievery Corporation and
You're a big music
OAR. Wow. I mean, it's amazing, this guy. It's good to be the club owner. They let you do those things. But he loves to eat. And I think I did for him and my wife and Caroline, his wife, a 12, 14th course menu. I was in the kitchen and I just was cleaning. You know, we had this Iberico roasted pork, ramen style. And I had this little asparagus with a little bit of leftover caviar. And we had a lot of things. So I did like a 12, 14th course, Japanese, but the Spanish kind of menu. So it was kind of interesting.
What's your daughter's favorite dish you make?
Well, lately, I don't know if it's my daughters are in the teenage area. I don't know if my daughters are in the teenage age or what. Everyone is always in a different phase.
Yeah. And
even they're, you know, 13th, 16th, 18th. And it's funny because everyone goes through a different phase, but My 18th, Carlota, just loves everything.
I remember going to Aspen 10 years ago, seeing her on stage.
Yeah, cooking with me.
Wow.
She's impromptu. 18. Unorganized.
I love it.
Then, you know, I think more than the dishes I make for them is the dishes my wife makes for them.
Oh, really? What does she cook for them?
Well, you know, I think the gazpacho of my wife is probably the most repeated recipe ever. She's been printed in New York Times, in every single magazine you imagine. Always my wife's gazpacho, no mine. She makes these chickpeas and spinach, which is a recipe from her mother that came from her grandmother. And my daughters love that chickpeas and spinach, kind of Moorish influence in South Spain dish. They love that. They love the lentils my wife makes.
Wow. We're not doing well on this.
If you are asking between what my daughters will choose, my wife cooking or my cooking, I don't know. I'm afraid to ask the question.
that's funny.
She's more reliable. I am more, as my Lucia, my youngest, will say, Daddy, you always have to try something new.
That sounds like my wife. Yeah. What's your favorite ingredient to cook with?
Oh, my God, so many. But let me tell you, a squid, I think, is the most underrated product in the world. But specifically, a problem we hope will become an opportunity. The shores of America produce, they have good squid. In North Spain, you have fishermen that they go and they catch one by one. And they usually use older fishermen or older men that retire, and they give them the permit and they can catch them one by one. And when they're fresh, I wish that Jeff Bezos and Amazon will put the service of their infrastructure to make sure we are able to bring those squid as they're caught from the source where they are fish to the restaurants or homes of the people that want them. Squid, they have a hard life in the sense that once you catch them, they don't have a love along when they're fresh shelf
squid,
life.
No.
So they need to get there. And when you get a squid and you cut one by one, not by net, with this special hook that kind of don't allow them to expose to throw the ink, and you get the full ink sac, and you use the ink sac to make a sauce. You asked me what I was eating yesterday. One of the dishes was a squid in ink sauce that we ate for New Year's Eve. And I'm not going to lie to you. A great squid is so many things you can do with it. But I love the simplicity of a freshly caught squid. Just simply sear with a touch of olive oil. Maybe a touch of garlic and parsley, maybe. And no cleaning, no touching. And just eating the insides that they become their own sauce. I will tell you, a squid is going to be my ingredient of the year.
All right. Name a smell in the kitchen you love.
A smell in the kitchen I love will be the smell of my mom's stew of roasted red peppers with garlic and vinegar. It's probably the dish she made the most in a little terracotta casserole. And this is a smell that I will even smell coming down from my school with this beautiful mountain in the back, and somehow in the way the kitchen was directed and the winds, I could smell that probably 20, 30 meters away.
Wow. How about a smell in the kitchen you hate?
Oh, I hate the smell of being greedy in the kitchen. Greedy is a smell. You can sense. I don't know if it's a smell that is a music. I don't know if it's John Steinbeck on The Pearl that he will speak about the music of the moments of life.
So interesting you say this. This morning, we launched our podcast episode with Massimo Bottura. And I asked him a smell in the kitchen he loves, and he said that I think he said like the smell of music is what he loved. That's very interesting.
Well, greedy in the kitchen means that you're not generous,
right?
With the love you put in, or the quality you put in, or the time, and that's many ways you can be. But I don't like that smell, and you can smell it. When we have that saying that smells, so that's fishy.
Yeah,
it's really a smell.
What pisses you off in a kitchen?
I mean, you know what? Maybe pisses me off that this is probably one of my biggest regrets as a person, as a man, is that the people work with or work with me, especially the ones that've been a long time. I want them to be the best they can. I don't know. I always think like one day I'm not going to be here. I'm not going to be around anymore. And I want everybody to be the best they can. And when I see that they don't do the best they can.
Got it.
Makes me upset.
What makes you happy?
Watching a kitchen just in full motion.
Yeah.
Working like, and under pressure, I'm working like nothing happens. We put a computer many years ago in the kitchen and was to try to create the most peaceful environment we could in what always was a chaos environment. Used to have a chef calling tickets. Was never the right way to manage a kitchen that is busy. All of a sudden, you put computers, and computers give you this kind of perfect...
like orchestrated.
Perfect wall that is more organized. And organization always creates more peaceful environments.
Interesting. So my last question is, where am I going for lunch right after this, before my next meeting?
We should go, Cina Chilcano is my latest
work. I was hoping you'd say that.
We have is this amazing Peruvian restaurant that very much probably happened after a drunk a night of pisco sours with Gaston Acurio in Peru and my team. And we were opening a Chinese restaurant, but obviously... with all the Asian, Chinese, Chifa, and Japanese Nikkei that happens in Peru, we were like, you know one thing? I've been, in the spirit, I'm Hispanic, I'm Latino, and I wanted to open this Japanese, Spanish restaurant at the old post office, what is now the Trump Tower, that for different reasons didn't happen. And I was like, you know what? Let's stop the construction right now, and let's open a Peruvian, which brings the best of one of the great cookings of the world that happens is from a Hispanic Latino country, and that has this amazing mix with this mix of Chinese and Japanese. So
sounds delicious.
I love that one.
Yeah. All right. This is my last question. So we've touched on a lot today. We touched on the industry, growing up in Spain. We talked about your daughters and food you cooked, food you love. With all that said, you posted a video on Twitter a couple of days ago that I saw. You said it made you cry. It was a gentleman doing good deeds for people, holding the door, giving them money. And at the end, the video said, "And in your life, what is it that you desire most?" So my question for you is, what do you desire most?
Well, desire is a double-edged word. Me, I just wish that if I could choose, I will, you know, with my wife when we'll be 80, with a little, probably a restaurant with probably a table of 6 seats attached to the kitchen, where we will go to the market, or we will get the fisherman calling us with what he caught right off the coast. The restaurant overlooking a beautiful sunset every day. And just being open for anybody will dare to show up in that place that will be in the middle of nowhere. I think the restaurant I'm going to call it will be Didi Wadidi, if nobody opens before. The Didi Wadidi comes from the WPA writings, the World Project that became World Progress Administration, or World Progress that became World Project. People don't know, but they changed names. And Didi Wadidi was an essay. I forgot the writer, man. How can I forget? That was about this amazing place that the Afro-American slaves were dreaming of going, where food will be plentiful, where the chickens will be big, and the sweet potato pie will be never-ending. And that was this man called the Moon Regulator, who was very big, and he will call the Moon Regulator because the days you didn't see the moon is because he didn't turn it on, I guess. He didn't fix it. And I would love to have the place, Didi Wadidi, cooking with my wife, hopefully with my children showing up once in a while, and friends, and just watching the sunset, or probably the sunrise of my life.
Awesome. Thank you, Chef. Yeah. I appreciate it.
Quote, "I don't do it sometimes to fulfill other people's dreams, but to fulfill my own dreams. And if you do things to fulfill your dreams, and you do it with the heart and love, eventually happens that you also fulfill other people's dreams." Thanks again to Chef Jose Andres. Find more on him at thinkfoodgroup.com or worldcentralkitchen.org. Join us next week when Beyond the Plate presents Just a Plate. This is a short segment where chefs describe a recipe, sharing insider tips on what makes this specific dish meaningful to them. Jose shares a recipe. It's a paella dish. It's paella valenciana, paella Valencia style. This is a true off-the-cuff recipe. We sat down on his couch in his office, no book, no recipe, no sheet, and I cannot wait to make it. For season 2 updates and happenings, please be sure to find me and keep up to date with the podcast across all social media platforms. I am at On Cappy's Plate, or you could go to beyondtheplatepodcast.com. Beyond the Plate Social on Twitter is BT Plate Podcast. We are also on Facebook. We have our own page. This episode was produced by myself, along with Ian Cohen, Joel Yeaton, and Sean Petrosian. Big thank yous all around. Our music has been composed by Goldford. You could find him at iGoldford. And a big special shout out to my wife, Katie, for her endless support. Please rate and or review and or subscribe to the podcast on your listening site of choice. We're on Libsyn, we're on Stitcher, we're on iTunes, we're on Google Play, and we are now on Spotify. Thank you for listening to Beyond the Plate. I'm Cappy, and remember, there are never too many cooks in the kitchen.